He preferred to make a bigger deal of coming home than leaving, so when he left, he just left. It was her husband's third tour. Katie joked the third time would be the charm. His last letter home read as follows. The movers stacked the boxes so high it would take a man to reach the top, unless Katie were to topple them over and break all the porcelain. Instead, she wrestled the real estate signpost out of the lawn and looked for a man. The house belonged to Katie now. Affordable, an acre of land, amazing views. From the kitchen window above the sink, Katie could see halfway to heaven while washing the dishes. When the baby came, she would wash him in that sink, his clear eyes seeing all the way to heaven for a while. She hung her husband's letter on the fridge, like a grade report from school, all A's and B's. He wrote pretty well for a man, and though it seemed a little silly, she decided to write back to him. Her closest neighbor lived in a farm across the street. The dairy barn was empty. The cows were either out to pasture, or lost, or dead, killed in a roadside bomb, killed for their meat. A dairy cow will have 100 babies for the cause, but what if the cause is no longer worth it? What if there's already too much milk to drink? It sounded like the bull was out behind the barn, beating his head against the wall, trying to break through the new sideboards or pry loose the old ones, anything to get back into that soft hay where he could ignore the slaughter of his babies. The next neighbor lived in a mobile home where the septic tank had clogged and swamped the bathroom, and the volume knob had broken off the TV. Someone was pushing furniture, dragging the couch to an open window, away from the smell and the pain of the television. The wind in the valley blew hard up the legs of the mountain, bringing guilt-free power to a couple of retirees. But the couple struggled to enjoy retirement. They were used to working full-time separate jobs, so they spent their new together time fighting. It would probably end in divorce. The woman would get the house. The man would take his windmill with him. In the master bedroom, classical music played on a stereo, while a young boy practiced his violin, playing along with the orchestra as best he could. If his practice was perfect, his parents would smile and click off the light. He could finally come outside. Even up top, the sound of that bull beating his way back into the barn continued. It had quieted some at the top of the hill, riding so far on the wind. It had quieted to a gentle rapping, someone at the front door with awful news. And then it stopped. It was her husband's third tour. At some point, it becomes a career. If it were her husband behind that barn instead of a bull deranged with sorrow, Katie would kill him. She would smash a rock into his head and kill him. At some point, you have to defend what you love, so you kill for your family. You kill to make space on the dance floor, or quiet in the library, or food on the table. You kill. But it wasn't a bull behind the barn, just a farmer playing baseball. He had a kind face, seemed clean, seemed good with his hands. He welcomed Katie to join his lonely game with her own. And because he had suffered too, Katie wouldn't have to explain to him that people die. They would both just understand. In that quiet way, he would make a good father. He could reach the highest boxes and help unpack.